Can I ask you what you did before you wrote the changes? I mean,
I was a journalist with Punch. I don't know how I came to write them, shall I?
Yes,
I was reviewing detective stories for Punch, and I had an idea for a detective story of my own, and I started to write it on the kitchen table after supper. And about two-thirds of the way through, when it seemed to be going very well, something at work happened which took me off it for a while. And then when I came back to it, I was totally stuck. I wrote about four pages in 2 months. And then, should we stop it, brother? Then around that Christmas, I had a nightmare, because I still have childhood type nightmares, effectively the first half of the first chapter of The Weathermonger. And I lay awake making sense of this dream I'd had, and I deliberately wrote the book in order to unblock my detective story. Enjoyed writing it very much, and then I felt I hadn't exploited this world where machines are wicked, which is quite a commonplace science fiction idea, adequately, and I wanted to write about a place where I was extremely, it meant a great deal to me when I was about 16 or so, which was the area around Painswick in Gloucestershire, where I changed the village a lot. The rest of the landscape is as it is, I made a much smaller village. And I wanted to write originally about a group of kids getting a big machine going. I thought it would be a trawler up a cowl or somewhere, but I then found out about the Gloucestershire Canal and decided to put a tug onto that. And then I thought there was room for one more, and I was writing adult books in between these. I thought there was room for one more in this world than I would have done with. The obvious thing was to go right back to the beginning and then it started. And that's how I came to do it.
So it wasn't deliberate to write a trilogy
to begin with? Not at all, because I think I said to you in my letter, the Merlin solution, which is the only thing I could think of for The Weathermonger, I think works in The Weathermonger, not perhaps fully in plot terms, but because of the way that the book feels and is shaped, but is not adequate for the whole story, for the whole trilogy. And I think Anna tried to find a different solution to this, and that doesn't work either.
Anna mentioned to me that she said in her interview that after the television was shown, that the ending of the book was changed to put in line with the television.
No, absolutely not. No, the one thing that was changed was that the American publishers didn't like the idea of Merlin being a morphine addict and asked me to think of something else. And I actually came up with a much better solution, which was that Mr. Furbelow had attempted to rouse him from his dormancy with a purely imaginary drug, which was theoretically used for bringing people around after deep freeze operations, and that this was an unnatural substance, and as he is a pure exemplar of Matura in some way or other, this was a poison in his veins, and he made him delirious so that he couldn't understand what was happening to him. And Sally then explains to him in the scene in the underground chamber what has happened to him, and he says thank you, and he now knows what's going on and he can cope with it. Which is intellectually a much better solution, but in the mysterious way these things happen doesn't have quite as much energy as the British solution, or the British version. You see, I was 40 when I wrote these books. I had no idea what I was doing. I'd never written a book before. And I had been a journalist. I was fundamentally a poet. And actually, if you look at some of that stuff, you could see that actually, you could argue that the language is really too poetical for a children's book. But this is a matter of taste. And is that my book?
I think that should be.
Copy. That's copy. No, that's copy. That's right. That's right. Incidentally, move your chocolate away from your coffee or it'll melt. One of the traps about this, but I'm afraid this place is a little bit more expensive than some you'll come for. That's how they came into being. And it is rather a bugbear for me now that they are still taught in schools. I've written like something like 20 other children's books of varying quality. But these are the ones which teachers who happen to be your age remember best.
It shows you how good the television
is. Well, possibly, yes. Well, I think the television series, as I said, my letter was patchy.
Yeah. I couldn't
give that
the ending. I mean, the ending of the television series, it's funny because when I remember it from when I was a child, I'm very hazy about the ending.
Yes.
In my mind, it was sort of pulled it out.
Well, the ending is hazy.
But watching it again, it poses too many questions.
Yes.
Nicky just almost can't answer. What's his name? The chap who's with him. The boy who goes to the cabin with him. He keeps asking a question about it.
Right. I don't remember what his name is. No. Either, because I don't remember which of them. In the books, they all have different names.
Yeah.
Also.
That was something I was going to ask you. Whose idea was it to have one character running
away? Well, I think Anna said she needed to do that, and I said, yes, that's a very good idea. It wouldn't have bothered me at all. It would be essential, you know, to make the thing go here. I think this is almost the first decision you would make, was who you would have, and obviously it's got to be Nicky because you're starting off with her. Did you know, she probably told you, that the switchboards were jammed after the opening scene by parents protesting?
Well, I was going to say,
because that's not in the book. That's the books that they've seen. You know about it slightly in a flashback.
Yes.
But actually, to have it made real of this kid whose parents suddenly smash up the home and then desert her is much nearer to a childhood nightmare than a lot of the things. Yes, indeed. And a lot of people were. It is much closer to a childhood nightmare than many of the things which people think are nightmares, like Nightmare on Elm Street or whatever. This is much nearer a child's true horror of the parents going mad and smashing up the home and then having left alone. And I thought she, partly because of her deliberately stolid acting, I thought she came over this. She actually did all this extremely well. I mean, you really did believe in this child. This is why I took hold on kids like your age. It's because of her.
Mm.
They empathize very strongly with her, I think. There's another element in that which might interest you, which is my American editor, when I sent her what I thought was the finished draft, said that Nicky's character didn't develop enough, didn't change, at least. And so I wrote in, it's not more than half a dozen paragraphs in the book, in various places, about her feeling that she cannot afford perfection anymore. And these turn out to be what the book is about. You know, they are actually an afterthought, and that was obviously used as part of the way that Nicky's character was built up. Don't remember it, I'm afraid.
No, just the sort of the sounds when the machines...
Oh, yes.
Sort of haunting effect. Did you actually attend any filming? Or?
I went to one bit of Heartsease when they were doing a tiny scene of getting the pony out of the farm. They spent, everything in television takes 2 hours, and so they spent 2 hours getting this pony out of the stable door. And that's all they were planning to do this morning. There were, I think, 2 lines of dialogue, and that was it. It was very boring. Have you come across an edition of The Changes as a trilogy? Those, I don't know whether I wrote the linking passages there after. No, I didn't. I wrote it before, because they also produced this. I think they produce a reference. There are 3 linking passages in there, which I think refer to the noise. You can pick up this business about the noise.
That sort of thing between
them. Yes, that sort of thing, yes. I wrote those when Golanx wanted to do a trilogy to go with the television series.
Yeah, okay. So that came out.
When that did, the Golanx published it to coincide with a picture from the book on the from the series on the front. Very boring picture it was too. I can't imagine why they chose it.
I believe you've done something else with Anna
Home
before then, is that
right? Yes, I wrote when she found she couldn't get this off the ground, I wrote a 6-part serial called Mandos, which was then turned into a book by a woman called Lois Lamplugh, L-A-M-P-L-U-G-H, who is very likely some relation of the Susie Lamplugh who disappeared from the same part of the world and so on. I don't think it was entirely successful, but it's again science fiction.
That was before this.
Before this, it was really almost instead of this, and they always seemed to be very pleased with it. There was a lot of internal politics going on in the BBC at the time. Did you tell you about this?
Yeah.
Well, this all started.
She's had a BBC
turn. Yes. Well, yes. Jack and Rory was not. They used to read, and then they started tiny dramatisations. And the drama department were very jumpy about this. Children's television was the lowest budgeted of all television except for religious programs. And the drama department didn't want Jack and Rory doing drama because it's empire building stuff. And they gradually built this up. And I think Mandel was one of the first ones they did off their own bat and managed. Anna, I'm sure, is a very competent politician in this field. And she, and this too, this is the reason why Doctor Who was so, for compared to the children's television at the time, was so, had such much better production values most of the time, was that it was done by the drama department, not by children's department. But for instance, there is a scene in the television, which is not in the book, which is crucial for changing from one book to the other, when a wheel comes off a cart, and this is utterly unconvincing. If they had had a little more money to spend, they would have done it again, I'm quite sure. You must have the tapes or something, have you?
I watched it. It was on UK Gold.
Oh, right, yes.
Just to quiz you a bit about the ending, I know it's probably not a very pleasant subject for you. I agree with you that your ending was better than the television version. Did you have any letters to you at the time?
No, none at all, surprisingly. The line I have always taken about adaptations, both of my adult and my children's books, which have come up a number of times. In fact, one of my children's books called The Gift was a television serial on two about 3 or 4 years ago, is that you can't make an adequate, satisfactory television or film by sticking too close to the book. They're such a different media, and therefore, why do you stick to the spirit of the book as far as possible? I'm happy with it. I have a hidden agenda in this, in that the more different the book is from the film, the less people are going to try and read my book and see that film. I don't want people constantly seeing Robert Redford or whatever it is as my heroes. The heroes of my adult books tend to be weeds and wimps, and so I would much rather have Robert Redford than a weed and a wimp, you see, because it's much more satisfying. I'm not against them being done, and a really good adaptation of a book does contribute something, but it's even so, you see, you may not have liked the Middlemarch adaptation, I'm sort of iffy about it, but nowadays these characters will suddenly pop into your mind while you're reading it, and this is contaminating, so the more different it is, the happier I am.
Were you writing the changes for a child audience?
But I thought of them as children's books. I thought of them very much as children's books. As you know, I do both kinds. And different ages, actually, the gap between doing that age of book and an adult book is not as great as the gap between doing that age of book and an 8-year-old book. That's a much bigger gap. Most of my children's books are adult novels, rather simplified and with certain things left out. Well, this is not, for the most part, what younger children's books are. It is far harder to write a young children's book than it is this age group. But I don't think an audience. Any successful book has a voice. And that voice comes into your head and tells you what to say. And, when you lose it, you're in trouble. And you you sometimes find your voice wobbly. That's dangerous. But it's not something which you have much control over.
I wrote this, I think I wrote it last year or earlier this year, and it's quite sort of, it's not what I would think is a typical children's book. I mean, it's quite serious.
I don't know how many children's books you've read, but in fact there are a lot of people.
I shouldn't say
typical. Well, there are a lot of very good writers who, I think of myself as a good writer. It's all right, I'll take it. But I like ideas. I like to try and make ideas accessible. I am something of a teacher. I mean, it's difficult. One shouldn't try and teach. Child should never be aware of being taught. But I recently wrote a book set in former Yugoslavia, effectively, in an imaginary country just before all this sort of mayhem started. And this book was, it's actually worked out very well as an exciting story, but I wanted to try and make people feel what it was like to belong to a little nation like that, how these things could happen. Imagine, this is what fiction, one of the things that fiction is for, to put you imaginatively into other people's shoes. It's not to tell you lots of facts, it's to tell you, this is one of the big differences between television and books, is television shows you. Television is rotten with ideas. It is very good. Burn a house down. It's quite difficult to burn a house down, but it takes a lot of writing to burn a house down. No problem in television. A discussion, or even an idea, in a book you can glimpse things. In television you have to have the cameras in there and all the lights in there to glimpse it, even. And everything becomes significant, and it's very difficult to wake things. And so it is much more a show. I'm not saying that it doesn't require any imagination, but it's... you can just watch television and hardly use your imagination at all. You can't read a book with satisfactorily. This is an enormous difference.
Are you writing at night?
I am a writer. If I'm not writing, then it's... I mean, it's like I say to kids when I go to schools, you go to a zoo and you see this great bird because one of its wings clipped so it can't bash itself on its cage. But it still is something made to soar above the Andes. If you stopped me writing, I would still be a writer somehow. I don't know how. Anyway, I don't know what this means. And I feel, well, if I'm not writing, I feel thin. I sort of begin to...
Do you find it easy
to write? When it's easy, it's easy. When it's difficult, I've spent the last 21 months writing a book which turned out not to be any good. I lost the voice, I lost it, I kept thinking I was getting it back, eventually I gave it up. In the middle of all this, I had an idea for a small children's book, and took time off to do this, and it was very, very enjoyable, it was all there, not because it was a small children's book, but because it was there.
Just
no
idea.
No, it was the rain had fallen on the hills miles away and come along the aquifers and come up in that particular well. That's all you could... you see what I mean? You don't know why it is that. There was water in that particular well and the other well was dry.
Is the change something that's important to you, or do you sort of think of the light
of rain? No, not at all. It's very important to me in the sense that it gave me a lot of the confidence I have as a writer. It enabled me to leave my job, and that and my adult books at the same time, enabled me to leave my job and start and support my family by writing books. I think I shall never write a book like The Weather Monger again, because no substitute for your first book. It's very flawed in certain ways. I couldn't write like that again. I think Heart's Disease is pretty good. I think The Devil's Children is almost as good, though people don't like it as much. I know what's wrong with it now, but I didn't at the time. I think I would find myself, I do go back and read my books sometimes, but close enough, I don't think I go back and read those very much. There are certain books which seem to be outside you, and others ones seem to be inside you. And I think Heartsease was inside me and came out, if you see what I mean.
What was the problem with The Devil's Children?
Well, it was not a problem. I mean, I think the Sikhs are too nice. It is too clearly got an anti-racist agenda in it. This is slightly undigested. That's the main thing I've got. It is, if you're going to teach a lesson, you must digest it so it doesn't look like a talk lesson.
I was going to ask you, when you were writing the three books, were you trying to make some message?
Nothing at all, no. They are ecological long before their time. I was ecological long before my time. I mean, this is just one of the things that's always interested me. Without thinking about it, theoretically. No, I'm a very primitive writer. I don't know what's going to happen in the book. I start on page one. Not at all. No, I make an island, and then I see what there is on the island to build with, and then I build my structure. I've said I've used this before, which is why it sounds a bit literary. Your imagination is an enormous sea, and you can't find it. Most of it is invisible to you, but it washes things up on the beach. And I'm a beach comber along the shores of my imagination. I pick things up and then see what I can make of them. And when you're really on form, all the bits that you need, this bit of whalebone, that bit of old ship's timber, fit together to make something which is really satisfactory. But you can't rule them out of the sea, by no means.